Yeah, let's start. Okay, anybody of you here, have you been involved or are you currently building something like microservices? Or something that you've determined a microservice? Yeah, I have also been doing that for some years now. And then when I get into discussion with people about stack that I use, and sometimes it was Jakarta E microprofile, and for some reason, then gets the conversation got very interesting, because a lot of people expected me to use the boot, but I didn't, mostly. So I'm here to tell you today about my experience with Jakarta EE microprofile and my kind of 15 years of experience with it, in the hope to inspire you also to start using this technology or keep using this technology in the best way possible. That you also have as much success with it as I have had, did have. So, for short, who I am. My name is Edwin Dirks. I'm a principal consultant at Team Roxas IT in the Netherlands. It's a consultancy company. We do a lot of Java consultancy, but also other stuff, cloud, Microsoft. But the Java area is my my terrain. And because I also like sharing my knowledge about Java and everything related, I also speak at conferences regularly, like I said, to share the gospel about why you should or should not use certain technologies. You can find me mostly on Twitter. Would you ever have questions for me? I'm also I'm always reachable in some way, especially Jakarta and microprofile related. So for this talk, this is not a hands-on session where I show you a lot of code. This is a more theoretical session about the hows and the whys you should use Jakarta EE microprofile in a certain way, because there are a lot of nuances to it, and this is what I would like to share with you today, mostly. So, to start off with a little bit of background so that we are all on the same page. Where are we now and where do we come from? So Java was kind of released in 1995, and very short after, like a few months already, the enterprise version of Java was created. So we determined standards about how to use database connections, how to generate HTML pages, like that. So that all started back in the 90s, and also shortly after Spring Framework was invented, because always somebody else thinks he can do better. So kind of these platforms, Java EE and Spring, they grew up together, looking at each other, learning from each other. And with the come of the cloud, they matured into something that we currently know as cloud native technologies, with from the Spring camp, the Spring Boot setup, and from Jakarta EE that was rebranded after Oracle moved over the Java EE codebase to Eclipse Foundation, rebranded Jakarta EE. And that is now complemented with the microprofile specifications for cloud native technologies. So we are here now with Jakarta EE microprofile. And like I said, I had very interesting conversations with people when using this stack for microservices, even though the platforms Jakarta and microprofile market, we are for cloud native Java. So why is that so interesting? Yeah, I think there's a little bit of the perception from the past. People think or have the perception that Jakarta EE is old. Now that is true, because it's like 25 years ago that this platform found its inception. Jakarta EE is slow. Ooh, what does that mean? It consumes a lot of resources and you cannot build microservices with it. That's the things I sometimes hear when talking with people. Admittedly, there is some truth in that, but not everything. I have been working with application servers 10, 15 years ago, and yeah, they were slow with hardware I had, that we had, and they consumed a lot of resources. But if you look at it now, is that still true? Because Jakarta EE as a platform is old, it means that it's feature rich. If you are starting with it today, everything you need or should need to build enterprise applications, database transactions, even WebSocket, stuff like that, is in it as a specification, so you can do anything with it. And if you miss something, it's open source, go ahead, do a proposal. But it means that the innovation has been mostly in implementations. These application servers that you know from the past are no longer the application servers that we have today. Runtime optimized, memory optimized, CPU optimized, there's so much innovation and healthy competition between the vendors that implement Jakarta and MicroProfile. So that is a really big thing. And you can still build microservices with Jakarta EE. You need a health check endpoint, for example, that you can still build with just a REST endpoint that you expose. That would be already be enough. But to really make Jakarta EE applications cloud native, you need fault tolerance and tracing and stuff like that. And MicroProfile provides that complementary to Jakarta EE. So wrapping that up, where are we today? Jakarta EE 10 was released a few weeks ago. And we are on the brink of releasing MicroProfile 6. And MicroProfile 6 is rebasing on the Jakarta EE core profile, which is new in Jakarta EE. And almost to the day, Jakarta EE 10 brings new features in the programming model after 5 years of moving over from Oracle to the Eclipse Foundation. So there's pretty exciting stuff happening there if you're a Jakarta EE developer. But this talk is not for managers, not for salespersons, it's for you as a developer, right? Because you as a developer have to benefit from using these technologies. So as a developer, you can see three areas. And the first is, what do you get from it? You have a developer experience using these technologies. You can build your application with it. And because Jakarta EE and MicroProfile define specifications in the form of Java interfaces, you have a programming model that you're using. Now, focusing on this as a developer should be your focus point because how it runs with the vision behind Jakarta EE and MicroProfile is ideally cleanly separated from what you have programmed. So running your application can be seen as a completely different track separated from what you have built. And the nice thing, Java itself also has a role to play there, but I will go into the details later. And this can also be separated from the infrastructure that you run it on, because Java is a cross-platform platform itself. So having to mix the ability to mix and match these layers, you can tune it until you have found the perfect situation for your project, and not just go with one thing like, I have Spring Boot, this is it, and it has to fit everywhere. It kind of does, but if you want to really squeeze out performance and CPU and everything that's optimized for you as a developer, you have to do something more with Jakarta EE and MicroProfile, but you have the ability to really make things work for you. So first, as a developer, what options do you have for building your applications? If you look at how you get started with a Jakarta EE or MicroProfile project, Maven is still the de facto tool to start. You make a pom.xml, you place these two dependencies in it, and you're good to go. These dependencies provide you the complete tool set of Jakarta EE and MicroProfile. You can use everything, literally everything, and what you don't use, you don't drag along. It's just a provided specification dependency. But if I look at my experience mostly with the Spring component-based model, you have to search for the dependencies that you need from the Spring initializer. And when you have found these, you have to add new ones when you are in need of new components. But over the years, over the months, over the years that of maintaining such a project, this, at least for me, it was a dependency hell. Always these conflicting dependencies, or this is updated and that not. And I really could not get a grasp on it compared to the clean dependency that I had in my Jakarta project that said, okay, this is it, this is what I work with. So for me, I have a big preference for how it's done with the provided dependencies from Jakarta EE and MicroProfile, which provide the interface to program against. Now, with these dependencies, you can start building your app you can build business software, and then when you think you're done, you can build your application with one of these options. Now, with the vision behind Jakarta and my profile, you ideally have a thin wall, a web archive that only contains the code that you have built and some configuration maybe, but just that. If you have, for example, a dependency, a database driver, a JSON parser, whatever, and you put that in your app, you're starting to get a fat war. You start to adding dependencies in your application that should ideally not be there. For Spring Framework, this is the way to go. Spring implements the servlet specification, and everything that you need for your Spring application is put into that web archive that runs on, for example, a Tomcat server that implements also the servlet specification. But it means that with the Spring application, you always have everything mixed in there, and that can lead to very conflicting things, like having three XML parsers from three different libraries that have transparently, transitively pulled that in, for example. So, pros, cons. If you take this thing one step further, you can create an Uber or Fat jar that also includes a complete application server or otherwise runtime to run whatever you have built as a process, as a Java process. And then there's a skin jar. It's a kind of a new kit on the block, which I will tell you more about later that I can better explain with an example. So, but which one is good for your project? Well, ideally, like I said, the thin bar, because it separates everything from your code. So there are some implications to having a Fat or Uber jar. And when I found out this Twitter thread, it became clear to me that I was not the only one seeing this. For this example that says I have the Spring application, I create an Uber jar with it, but hey, because I don't know what I'm dragging in, I just trust in Maven Central and the internet to provide me with stuff, there are some vulnerabilities in it. And if you don't know that or don't care about that, you can put something in production that you think is fine, but is vulnerable without you knowing. Is that not the case for thinbar or fatbar or skimjar, you say? Yeah, kind of, but I will go into the details later there. But that, to summarize this, you have an implication on using whatever packaging type you use, whether it's a thinbar or a fatbar or an Uberjar. So, with these runtimes, the build artifacts defined, you can also start running them, because without an implementation, you cannot run your app. Especially a thin bar is just a brain dead thing. It's nice bunch of Java code and configuration, but you have to run it. So what options do we have there? A few things you already mentioned, but the new one here is the application server and the HoloJar. And first we're going to look at our good old friend, the application server. Last week I heard somebody say, well, application servers, these are a thing of the past. I was like, I tend to disagree. Like I said, innovation is mostly there because the standards and the platform specifications are still there. So if you look at a microprofile and Jakarta E-compliant application server, can be anything. These are implementing these Maven specifications we already use in our project, which I have shown earlier. Which means that the app you have built should fit nicely onto this application server. And because it's based on standards, it doesn't matter which application server you use, you can swap it because, standards. But this also doesn't do anything. You need Java to run the whole thing, and then the circle is complete. You have mixed and matched the packaging type you want with the application server you want and the version of Java you want. Now, what you have there is an application server that is not managed by you, but by a vendor that implements these standards. And a nice thing for you as a developer, if there's a vulnerability, you can ask the vendor or provide a fix there, hey, this needs to be fixed, and then you get a new version of your application server, and then you're good to go. You don't have to plow through your fat var or Uber jar, where is it, where is it, I cannot find it, or how do I solve it. You can transfer the responsibility for fixing it in the product to the vendor, and that's really nice from a developer's perspective. So which application should you use? It depends. There are several. I have been using Payara in the past with great success. But there are lots nowadays. In the past, we didn't have this list. I had to find out which application servers were available. But nowadays, at the Jakarta EE website, you can exactly see which application servers you can use and find out which one provides the best features and support and stability for your project. Then, next to the application server, there's the HoloJar. Also from Payara, they provide a different edition. There's a Payara Micro that also is based on the same specifications, of course. And essentially, it's the same thing. You deploy an app on the application server and you run it with Java, but this thing is not the application server as we know it, because this is made for running into a cloud environment where you do not necessarily or cannot run log into the running service. So you don't need a management console there, and other stuff that you don't or cannot use there is stripped out. So the Payara micro distribution is a slim distribution of the application server, but still it implements these specifications, so you can still run your app there. Then going forward with that, again, specifications, we can create an Uber jar. It's a Java archive with your code in it. Again, you can, for example, use Payara Micro here and run it with the supported version of Java. But the thing here is everything is put into the same package. So if you want to move your code, you also need to move your application server. There can be several megabytes, so in certain cases that might not be desirable, as I will tell you about later. And then there's a skimmed jar, also based on our specifications that we already have seen several times. But to emphasize that, you can, whatever way of deploying or running you want, as long as you stay to these specifications as a developer, you don't have to switch programming model. You can still use what you know and then switch how you are going to use it. So the skimmed jar, like I said, is a new kit on the block. It's a Java archive. It's still your application code in it. But Quarkus from Red Hat does it differently. They provide a runner, to call it like that. And there's also a little bit of code inside your application server, inside your jar, that is not the real application server, but it runs like one. But still, it cannot do anything without implementation. And that's a set of libs that are put next to the jar that you have built. So the trick here is also to run it with a certain version of Java, of course. But this is kind of the component-based model that Spring also uses. So it kind of leans there. So you have to define which modules you want to use in Quarkus for your app. So you can mix and match and leave out what you don't need. And this all is optimized for modern cloud-native development without having the baggage of a complete application server. Although it uses the best breeds of that ecosystem inside the Quarkus components that are made available. And the funny thing is, with this, Red Hat mostly is marketing Quarkus as a product that is based on the standards that we know, but also on Spring. Because these programming models are for you as a developer, the buttons that you use to tell the application server what to do, what your code must do, of course. So you can even more put more programming models onto it if you want to. But since not only Jakarta and MicroProf, but also Spring programming model are supported for Quarkus, even Spring developers can use Quarkus and say still
tell people I'm a Spring developer because I use AutoWired instead of AtInject, for example. So this is the newest thing on enterprise Java. But we're not there yet. I told you earlier that Java also has a role to play in how you run things and can mix and match. Because who of you here knows which JVM he or she uses in this project? One. So the JVM from Java itself, I don't know if everybody knows it, but it's also a specification. So in the past, Oracle or in the time Sun had their own hotspot JVM. That was the default implementation that you probably use whenever you use download Java from the internet. But IBM in the past, they created their own JVM for their products, but it was based on the same specification as the JVM from Sun and later Oracle. So that means that even with the JVM, you can swap out the hotspot JVM and put in another, like Eclipse OpenGNI. This is the IBM donated version of their JVM to the Eclipse Foundation. And in the past, I have seen some results there on conferences here, for example, but also experimented with it. And indeed, you can swap a JVM and then have a different effect on running your application servers. This is really neat. So to give you more grasp on what's happening there, I took once the Payara micro distribution and I run it with hotspot JVM and then with a warmed up tuned OpenGNI. And I saw, yes, there is a difference consistently in how that thing started. So then I created a simple application and run it on the same setup. You see here the startup time increased like 3 seconds. And for the tuned version, 2 seconds. But to emphasize, there's really a difference in how you could use your application out of the box, and when you are starting to think of it and tuning it and putting effort in it, you could have different results. I did the same a few months ago with another version of Payara, and the numbers are kind of consistent, but also it got a little bit slower. Maybe it was because my laptop or whatever, but that's not the point. I want to point out, if you put your application server to the test on performance and put a new version on it, it is not necessarily going to be better or worse. So you have to really monitor constantly what's happening there. And this is also not about which is the best JVM. That's not the point. You only know what's the best JVM for your project when you start measuring that. And for example, I put the Visual VM profiler on it. And although I saw my app running with hotspot JVM and with OpenGNI, from a developer's perspective, I was like, yeah, it runs. It doesn't fall over. It doesn't run out of memory. What's wrong with it? But then you start putting a profiler on it, and then you see things happening. So with the Spring Pet Clinic that I run here, you see that the hotspot JVM takes about a gigabyte of memory almost out from start, and later on it does that. But the CPU is very stable. But when you use OpenJ9, you see that it uses way less memory, but the CPU is very erratic. So this can be good or bad for your app in regards of what it needs to do and how stable it runs. So having insights in your application server and the JVM that you use is very valuable. And don't just take for granted, oh, it runs, so it should be good. Now, switching to another JVM is very easy nowadays, especially because Eclipse also provides OpenJDK builds in this form with Tamarin. And you can there choose which operating system and JVM you want. And why go through all this trouble? Well, in the cloud, you can save money by optimizing your CPU and memory usage for your app. And yeah, if it starts faster, you can have a better experience in scaling up and down your app. Might that be necessary? But for me, it's mostly stability and knowing how my patient actually feels, that's what's important to me. And last but not least, if you have an application server and you want something fixed or you want support there, check with your company if there's a support contract, because this can provide you with a different version of your application server, a supported one, or if you have an issue, you can have it fixed with a patch from the vendor instead of having it go through the community, which not necessarily gives you a guarantee on how fast things get fixed. So how are you on time? Oh, nice. So now we know how to build our application, how we can run it, and what options that you have there. We can also choose how to deploy this. And then I come back first to the thin wall. If you build an application with Jakarta EE, a microprofile, you have some code and stuff like that, you might be surprised that ultimately the amount of code that you generate is just like 5 kilobytes, not megabytes, not gigabytes, kilobytes. So if you don't put all your dependencies in there, which can be megabytes and megabytes of library code, then this is just your app, a few kilobytes of Java, compiled Java code. And that fits nicely in a Docker layer. So if you have to push this all the time to a remote Docker repository, if you have the UberJava, for example, with hundreds of megabytes in size, you're pushing and waiting for these megabytes to go over all the time. With the thin wire, you don't have to. So this is an optimization for your development process that you can take advantage of. And also, Docker provides images for Java, but also maybe with an application server on it, like Payara. If you want to take full advantage of the thin wire principle, then you can take a Docker image that is safe, that you have determined safe, that is working for you with an application server, from a trusted source, not necessarily Maven Central, but also maybe an internal company, internal artifact repository. You can put all these images, these libraries, onto your Docker image. And then you can, like I said in the previous slide, your app, you can always change the app there. But the key here is, if you determine you have a Docker image at all the libraries and that should be the one for your app, this is immutable and this is the one you ship. You've created it once, then you can use it everywhere. So from a security perspective also, this makes things much more auditable, explainable to your security officers, and you can feel more safe as a developer and DevOps engineer that what you have put into production and get asked later what you have put in production, that you can have the proof that actually was this and not that you have to try to recreate what you have put into production in the past. So having Docker, that means we also can put it in orchestrators. And what we're going to put there is, like I just described, the Docker image with your chosen Java version, your chosen runtime, and your chosen artifact type. And this is your app that's going to run into a cloud native environment. You can use Docker Compose locally to really verify that if it runs there, then it should also run in a cloud native environment with a container orchestrator, because Docker Compose provides you all the injection and networking, just like it mimics from Kubernetes. And that means that if you have Kubernetes running in your test acceptance production environments, you can put that same image there and it should run. You don't have to change it anymore. It's safe. It's exactly what you expect there. And you don't have to change it all the way to there. So that's pretty neat. And in the end, Kubernetes doesn't care. Maybe I should have printed that somewhere on t-shirts or whatever, but Kubernetes is not interested in what you're running. If it's Spring Boot or .NET or whatever Java application, it needs health check endpoints to determine if your app is running. And with MicroProfile, you have a say in that. With MicroProfile, you can determine with health check endpoint API what makes your app healthy, would you like to. But to emphasize here, whatever combination of application server, app, library, which specifications you use inside, it doesn't matter for a cloud native point of view, but what's running in there if this and this and this has been thought of by you as a developer, as a DevOps engineer, and made as performant, as stable, as efficient as possible, your cloud, your boss and your cloud provider probably will thank you for that. Then you have to, yeah, this is how you take the most out of Jakarta EE and MicroProfile when you are putting everything together. So to summarize, as a developer, mostly you can focus on build and leave the running part to everything that other people are like and are good at. So you have options there to ship your application. Running it also provides possibilities in efficiency. And how you put it in the cloud. Use current day standards with Docker and Kubernetes, and then you should be fine. Now, would you like to know more about Jakarta EE and MicroProfile? The websites there are the kind of the portal to go anywhere you want for what you want to know. The GitHub projects are there, the open source, you can see everything, you can provide input, documentation, code if you would like to. But you can also participate or listen on the mailing list, what's going on there, and especially as an end user, vent your opinion there, because you can be the one steering the evolution of these technologies. Because as an end user, you are benefiting from what's happening there. So that was all I had to say today, and I think we're just in time. Yeah. If you want to know anything more, you can always contact me, like I said, via Twitter. I will be here all day, so you can ask me anything on the floor. I will always be happy to help and answer your questions. So thank you for being here. So are there any questions for now in the few minutes that we have left? Then I will give you the microphone. Because of the recording, if you don't mind.
So from a developer perspective, I'd like to ask you from your knowledge or your past projects, if there's a way the developers see the benefits from like a Quarkus jar deployment approach versus the Payara micro thin war approach, because there I kind of see the point having this in development mode in Quarkus speed up aspects versus the very, very neat standardized API approach of Jakarta EE, which is not kind of similar in terms of deployment or development even. Do you have some words on what the projects you are participating have in mind or do in the last year or something like that?
Yeah, so like I said, I've been using Payara for the last couple of years. And with the development process that I had, we used the Payara way of doing things, because as far as I know, we don't have a remote development stuff like Quarkus have there yet. But when you look at Quarkus and tell people why they should use Quarkus, and especially how Red Hat markets it, using the specifications is not their main selling point. It's you can put something with Quarkus in a remote Docker container that's running, and you can update your code from your laptop there. That for a developer could make sense to just work on a remote location, not running everything on a laptop. So the developer experience could get better for a developer using Quarkus by using these features. And as a side effect, Red Hat also provides the specifications from Jakarta EE and MicroProfile and Spring, that if you are a developer familiar with these specifications, you can get best of both worlds. You have an API that you know, you can create enterprise software that you know with the perks that Quarkus provide from his marketing and his product perspective. Does that answer your question?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
okay. Thanks. One more question. Otherwise, again, thank you for coming.